So without wasting any time, let's just say on Trending Tonight what the Supreme Court has said. Is it time we define the limits of sedition? I mean, this is something we've debated extensively in this country on how sedition laws are misused. Many people basically saying, why do we need this colonial era law in modern India? Well, the truth is that politically it's quite potent, and that is why governments like to use it. But now that the Supreme Court says there's time we define the limits of sedition, will we? Will the political class do it? That's the big question. Let's quickly take a look at what this case was, just to give you a perspective. Let's put those graphics on screen. Well, the top court gave relief for Telugu channels. They said that the Andhra Pradesh police, they booked two Telugu news channels on charges of sedition. The channels were booked for airing comments of a rebel YSR Congress MP. So that's why the Andhra Pradesh government booked cases under sections of sedition, 124A of the Indian Penal Code. Now, let's tell you what the court said on this. It's very, very important for you to tell you. The court said, Andhra Pradesh government should not take any coercive steps against the Telugu news channels. The Andhra Pradesh government's act of filing sedition cases against the channels is muffling the channels. It is time the court defines sedition. The most important line of what the court said. We are of the view that the ambit and parameters of the provisions of sections 124A, which is sedition, 153A and 505 of the Indian Penal Code 1860 dealing with sedition would require interpretation, particularly in the context of the right of the electronic and print media to communicate news, information, and the rights, even those that may be critical of the prevailing regime in any part of the nation. I think no other court or no other judgment can be as clear as daylight as this. Let's also tell you what Justice Chandrachud said on sedition. And this is also very, very important. He says that there was a picture of a body being lifted and thrown into a river. A picture of a body being lifted and thrown into a river. I do not know whether complaint of sedition will be filed against the news channel for showing it. It was NDTV. I don't know about others, but we showed that story right here on our channel. So this, I think, is a sarcastic comment on the manner in which sedition cases are filed in this country. And this is not hidden from anyone. All of us know. Now, what is Article 124A? Let's quickly tell you that also. 124A is a law which was made during the British Raj. It's a British legacy, which is still going on. Why? Because it suits the political fraternity. We'll discuss this in great detail as we go along. The law lays down punishment for sedition. Anyone who brings or attempts to bring into hatred or contempt or excites, and I'm quoting the law, or excites or attempts to excite disaffection, and here's the key word, towards the government shall be punished. You know, you put this in the British context and you will make sense. But why is this British legacy being lugged on even now? Perhaps it suits political parties, as was evident in this particular case, that you don't like someone, you want to shut someone up, put 124A. That's the point. This is what the law says. There is punishment also, imprisonment up to 3 years to a life term. A fine may also be added. Now, of course, there were additions and interpretations where the Supreme Court said, the court said in various judgments that only if there is violence, then in that case, you can invoke sedition. But the point is, and most important point is, that even now, the law is open to interpretation. And that is why we come back and circle back to the over-the-shoulder that we got you right here, the main topic that we want to discuss right here. We'll put that on the screen. Is it time we define the limits of sedition? Let's quickly put that on screen. Is it time we define the limits of sedition in the words of the Supreme Court? Let's introduce our guest this evening, Justice B.A. Khan, former Chief Justice of the Jammu and Kashmir High Court, Mr. Vikas Singh, Senior Advocate of the Supreme Court, President of the Supreme Court Bar Association, Sumant C. Raman, senior journalist and political analyst, Adil Singh Bopurai, spokesperson of the Congress Party, Sanjay Pinto, advocate of the Madras High Court, and Ashutosh Srivastava, political analyst and advocate of the Supreme Court. It's an important discussion. We'll take the views of everyone on board, because what we decide here and what we discuss here will open the minds of people, perhaps forcing the political dispensation to take some action as far as sedition laws are concerned. I want to begin with you, Justice Khan. What do you think?
Sanket, as you may be knowing, and most of the panelists may be knowing, there are already guidelines laid down by the Supreme Court in Kedarnath's case. The problem is not defining the limits or setting out some limitations. The problem is of implementation. So, for example, it's already laid down that the sedition case will arise only if there is an incitement to violence, if there is an incitement to disaffection of public order, and so on and so forth. But the issue is that on a complaint, it's a cognizable offense. On a complaint, a person is arrested, and it takes him months and months and years to say or to prove or to justify that your allegation does not meet out the requirement of the law laid down by the Supreme Court. So I'm seeing this is welcome, the observations made by the Supreme Court in this case is a welcome, but that observation does not lead to improvement of any situation on the ground.
Yeah.
In the past few years, we have been seeing a frequent misuse of this provision of law. And for every difference of opinion or for every dissent, a case is filed under Section 124A.
Correct.
And that case leads to such a harassment against the accused, that he goes on try, he gets firstly arrested, he remains in jail. Some people have remained in jail for 2 months, 3 months, that cartoonist. Now, after going through that jail term, then he comes out, then he is subjected to the mill of a court trial, which court trial lasts for months and months and months. And ultimately, it is ultimately proved that no, Supreme Court has said that there must be a backed up incitement by violence, or there must be a of a public order. So in my view, number two, the observation made by the Supreme Court is welcome in the sense, but how do you get an opportunity? I am told that there is an appeal already pending in the Supreme Court, or there have been cases, harsh cases, which have been brought to the notice of the Supreme Court. But all the same, there has to be some willingness or some positivity to lay down a law if you think that the provision of this law is being misused.
Very, very important point that Justice Khan is mentioning. Vikas Singh, I want to come to you, Mr. Singh. It's lovely to speak to you after so long, Mr. Singh. Justice Khan mentioned Kedarnath Singh's case, Mr. Vikas. It also says, the Kedarnath Singh case also says that if there is incitement of violence, then in that case, the provisions of this law can be pressed into service. My only point is that this is even now a matter of interpretation. Mr. Singh, why are we trying to retrofit an old law to make it relevant? And why not have a new law? Say for instance, you feel the need for a law like this, scrap this, get a new law with proper provisions.
Well, this law was brought into the Indian Penal Code in 1870 by the Britishers. And you will note, I don't know whether you're aware, Britishers have done away with this law in their own country.
Correct.
So it's still continuing in our country.
Correct.
Now, secondly, when this law was kept on the statute book when we got independence, probably at that time, probably nobody, looked at every section and saw which ones to retain or not retain. So the Supreme Court in Kedarnath Singh said that, well, sedition can't be invoked simpliciter because there is some disaffection of whatever, the government of the day may feel. But it must result in excitement to violence. And Kedarnath Singh also said something more important. Kedarnath Singh said that just because you criticize the Prime Minister person who is holding the particular office or a chief minister, that will not amount to sedition. It has to be the government of the day. So it has to be the authority of the government, not the prime minister as an individual or a finance minister or a home minister. So sedition law is completely being misused in this country, and there is no purpose of further redefining it, because the more you redefine, the more loopholes, because ultimately the bigger problem in this country is of not having police reforms. If a police officer were to analyze a particular FIR or an allegation that a case for sedition is made out or not, and if the police officer were to look into the Kedarnath Singh judgment and then say that, look here, I'm sorry, the ingredients are not made out. You may make out a complaint. If a complaint is made of sedition and the ingredients are not made out, it need not register the FIR. FIR has to be registered only if the ingredients are made out.
Correct.
Now, in the case of Vinod Dua, where he was also charged with sedition,
correct,
I have already filed a case. Dr. Justice Khan probably is referring to that. In Vinod Dua's case, I have said that, and Supreme Court has reserved judgment, the sedition case has been stayed by the Supreme Court. It was a Himachal case, you know, where he was talking about the government and they have said that this amounts to sedition.
Yeah.
I have said that for journalists of a particular standing, before registering any criminal case, there should be a committee, independent committee to examine, like you have in the case of doctors. Supreme Court has said that you can't register an FIR against doctors without having a committee of doctors looking into that whether a criminal case is made out or not, because it could be mere negligence or it could be mere oversight by a doctor. It should not be taking the doctor to a criminal court. Similarly, for the journalist, although there is a caveat, in our constitution, unlike the US constitution, there is no word of journalist mentioned.
Correct.
The only mention is a citizen, the other speech right in India, in our constitution, unlike in the US.
Now that's another reform we need, Mr. Singh.
yes, probably you do. But that is why I am espousing your case by saying that journalists, at least of a particular standing, because journalists doesn't have to be, qualification to be a journalist in that sense. Anybody
correct.
Can claim to be a journalist.
Correct, correct.
So a journalist of a particular standing should have this protection in our country, because journalists do a very important job of disseminating information to the people of this country.
While I'm not advocating a case for greater immunity and protection for us, what we are basically saying, Mr. Suman Sriraman, is why do political parties feel that, see, this is a political law. And we are carrying on this British legacy, even though they have done away with it, simply because it suits various political dispensations over the years. You wanna shut someone up?
Yeah.
Apply the provisions of this law.
Sanket, I think there are issues there. One political party
is in power, whether it is center or state, they are more than happy to misuse the law. And this cuts across political, rivalries and so on. Okay. So parties which speak very strongly about the need to ban the sedition law, once they get into power, they are as liable to misuse it as anybody else. Now, there's just two points that I want to make. One is that there are virtually no consequences for the one who misuses the law. The process is the punishment, as Justice Khan just said. Somebody is arrested, somebody spent months in jail, then he comes out, then the case drags on for several months, and then he is acquitted. What happens to the person who filed that case, the state, knowingly that there was hardly any evidence for getting a verdict, a conviction in a sedition case? So the problem is there are no consequences. And unless there are consequences, why should the policeman, the politician, or whoever it is who is initiating the action even bother to think twice before filing a case? There are no consequences. And you can arrest somebody, you can throw them in prison for several months, and it's going to be a huge problem for them, and their lives are going to be significantly impacted. It also sends out a very strong signal to the other journalists who may want to be doing stories that are maybe genuine, but are critical of the government. So that serves a dual purpose. And unless you build in some corrective mechanism, obviously, ideally, it makes sense to scrap this whole law. But short of that, even if you need to retain it for those who incite violence against the state, the least that can be done is to ensure that there are consequences when cases are foisted, knowing fully well that there is no sedition.
So there has to be punishment for those misusing the law. Mr. Boparai, I want to come to you now. You know, the point that Mr. Raman was making is very significant. While you were in power, this law existed, right? This law, there were attempts to do away with this law, but the Congress governments since independence were not successful in doing so. Even now, the present dispensation is not successful in doing so. In fact, all governments have been accused of misusing this very law and its provision. Is it a political law, a political tool, which makes it so indispensable?
Well, Sanketji, the Congress party firmly believes that the time has come to have a rethink on this legislative provision. It's as simple as this. I won't mince words in saying that. The problem today is that the Bharatiya Janata Party is using the sedition law as a tool to suppress information and arm twist critics. Now, sedition cannot be invoked to minister to the wounded vanity of the government. Ever since the pandemic has broken out, you've seen that the government has tried to suppress information or the scale of the problem. As far as sedition is concerned, Mr. Vikas Singh and Justice Khan are right. Kedarnath's judgment lays down the contours, but let me go further. In 1995, which is the Balwant Singh case versus the state of Punjab, the Supreme Court said that mere utterances or statements or sloganeering without consequential violence will not tantamount to sedition. You have seen time and again, whether it was Disha Shalyan's case, whether it's the other cases against journalists in Uttar Pradesh, SOS appeals on Twitter seeking oxygen. The BJP cannot misuse sedition. Today in this country, the problem is that the BJP has equated Mr. Modi or the BJP with India. They consider this to be synonymous. So the moment there is criticism, they invoke sedition. The government needs to realize that these are all manifestations of a fascist
outlook. While I agree with what you're saying,
you cannot be repulsive to criticism or accountability.
You cannot absolve Congress governments of doing exactly the same. I hope you have not forgotten the case of Mr. Asim Trivedi when the India Against Corruption movement was happening, when UPA 2 was in power. I hope you have not forgotten the fact that very recently in Rajasthan, provisions of sedition have been used politically.
Let me respond to that. We today, Sanket, are at a crossroads in our country. And today at this crossroad, the Congress party sincerely believes, this is not just a statement, this is not an empty statement,
that this law must
go. Congress party sincerely believes that the time has come for the Parliament of India to rethink on the need for such a statutory provision, a colonial relic.
Okay.
But you cannot divorce the fact that the BJP has been increasingly using this against members of your profession. Those who are exposing the extent of the devastation caused by the pandemic. Or against political critics. Just because I disagree with Mr. Modi, that doesn't make me anti-national or a traitor.
Correct.
This is fundamental to the organic nature and the robustness of our democracy.
Okay, let me get in an opinion. I'll come to you, Mr. Srivastava, in just one moment. Sanjay Pinto, you know, the need to scrap this law versus the need to define this law. I think that's the debate right here. Where do you stand on this issue? And do you feel that if we keep defining, as Justice Khan said, the definition is right out there. The problem is that the very foundation of this law is wrong.
Sanket, dissent is a safety valve in a democracy. If there is no dissent, democracy will burst under pressure. Not my words, but words of the Supreme Court not long ago in an interim order in the Romila Thapar case. We must understand, as you rightly pointed out, that this word, this term disaffection, was actually borrowed from the Vernacular Press Act, and that was meant to actually muzzle public opinion to prevent any popular uprising. The Constitution of India, in fact, the framers of the Constitution thought it fit not to include the term sedition in the reasonable restrictions to free speech. The role of the media, Sanket, is to play an adversarial stance, take an adversarial stance, not to be a propaganda machine, but to speak truth to power. There will be a chilling effect. Now, already there are so many reasonable restrictions that is, I wonder if they are reasonable at all. So it's for a particular reason that the term sedition was not included in that list. What was included instead? was public order. So therefore, there has to be a cause and effect, which is why in that landmark Jagjivan Ram case, it said, it equated, it said there must be, the relationship should be one of a spark and a powder keg. And unless there is some, because even if you look at, there are three explanations in 124A IPC. It talks about expressing disapprobation of the measures of the government with a view to obtain their alteration by lawful means without exciting or attempting to excite hatred, contempt, or dissipation does not constitute sedition. Then it also talks about, disapprobation of administrative action. So I think, as you said, we need a new law. Perhaps we need to make a distinction between country, nation, and government. Merely because you take a different, a contrarian view, and you play your role, the fourth estate is meant to actually criticize, to have constructive criticism, to call out what the wrongdoing in society. And if you're going to slap them with a sedition law, that will have that classic, chilling effect. And to quote Chief Justice Jackson of the Supreme Court, who once said, it is not the duty of the government to keep citizens in check. It is the duty of citizens to keep the government in check.
Well said. Brilliant. Absolutely correct. Mr. Srivastava, I want to come to you now. I think enough and more people on this panel have made this case that this law is old, this law is archaic, and this law needs to go. And yet, we have more and more governments, and since in the center and in some of the states you've got BJP governments, everybody does it. But when you are in power, questions will be asked of the BJP. Provisions of 124A are pressed into service. It is convenient.
Yes.
I want to know from you, why should this law not be scrapped? What is the argument against its scrapping?
I don't think there should be any argument against it. There have been many laws, many sections which have been scrapped earlier also by the Honorable Supreme Court, considering many such PILs like 477, 497 have been scrapped by the Supreme Court of IPC. And what I feel is that, if there is misuse of such laws which prescribes, severe punishment even for the life imprisonment under Section 124A sedition, which we are talking about, these sections are to be, utilized by the authorities by applying their mind and looking at the, complete circumstances of the case. If these section is, misutilized, then obviously, the fundamental rights given by the Constitution of our country, especially Article 19, which prescribes freedom of speech and expression. So, this kind of constitutional guarantees are at stake. And people of this country who, appoint or they elect the governments, and after electing the governments, they start taking advantage of these laws. If they are not performing up to the mark, it is the, people's duty and, give such kind of...
It's the people's duty. I think it's only people's pressure that can get politicians to even bring this to parliament. Because right now, Mr. Vikas Singh, the thing is that you speak to all political parties. If you get a consensus on this panel, it'll appear as if tomorrow if there were a parliament session, immediately this law will be scrapped. However, that has not happened for 70 plus years. Because the opinion that people have, learned people outside parliament have, and the opinion of politicians inside parliament seems to be very different. It's a very convenient law to keep on.
Well, Sanket, if you ask me that just because a law is being misused, it should be scrapped, I don't agree. Because I'll tell you why. If the law as it stood in the statute book were to remain, probably it should have been scrapped. But the law as it is there in the statute book has sufficiently been watered down by the Kedarnath judgment. Now, after having watered down that law, I think the rest of it can remain. So there can be cases where people incite violence, and there can be cases where, you may want to, bring down public property or parliament or Supreme Court, etc. That could be still part of sedition. I would rather say that Supreme Court should make it exemplary in the cases before it and make it a law that whoever registers a false case of sedition, a case which does not come within the ambit of Kedarnath Singh,
must be,
Wherever it is registered, the complainant should be, a case should be registered against the complainant in all cases, and the police officer registering the case should be suspended and a departmental inquiry be ordered against him. I think that's the way forward. Because
but you know, Mr. Singh, the problem is that these laws are often registered because of a political motive. A political dispensation orders people that go register this law.
So if
we will punish some minion.
No. If there is a political dispensation, no police officer will risk his career or his worthy for the purpose of pleasing his political master.
I think that's the
Similarly,
point.
Similarly, no complainant will come forward if he knows that a contra case is going to be registered against him for having made a false
case. I think that's
the
point
crime.
That Mr. Raman also made.
I think the better
it's a very significant point.
A lot of laws can be said correct. To be, you know, struck down only because it is being misused.
Let's just hope
the law is no ground for striking down.
Correct. Very interesting. Let's just hope that the consensus on this panel is also the consensus in Parliament. And if public pressure makes things happen, then why should there not be public pressure to either scrap or redefine this law called sedition? As of this moment, it appears very, very draconian. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us.